Okay. So good evening, everyone, and welcome to this talk titled The Fragments We Hold, A Songwriter's Notes on Process by Akhila Ramnarayan. This is an event jointly hosted by the Center for Creative Writing and Translation at Tsai University and the CMI Arts Initiative. For those of us at Tsai, this is a really special evening because this is our first in-house center talk. So welcome, Akhila. I think we should formally welcome you, even though you're one of us. Thank you so much for readily and generously agreeing to give this talk and for prepping so hard for it. I know you must have. For those of you who don't know Akhila, let me begin by saying that she's one of the most talented, versatile people I know. She combines scholarship with art and performance seamlessly. I don't know how she does it, but she does. Akhila is a scholar, a theater actor, and an indie musician. She is, as I said, a professor of literature at Tsai University. She's actually serving as Dean of the School of Arts and Sciences at Tsai. Akhila completed her PhD in postcolonial studies from the Ohio State University in 2006. And subsequently, she started to work in theater and music, in addition to, of course, her academic pursuits. She's fascinated by the interplay of genres and forms across cultures and time periods. Akhila will speak to us about what makes a poem, and what makes a song a song. Joining her as a last-minute surprise gift to us is her musical collaborator, Doug Carraway, who is turning 50 today, I'm told. So happy birthday and welcome.
What? Really?
Yes, and I think Akhila will introduce him soon. So over to you, Akhila. Thank you once again for being here.
Thank you so much, Srilata. I'll just go ahead and share my screen without wasting any time because I know everybody's time is precious. I so appreciate everybody joining us here today. And I'll just start my slideshow. Talk is titled because the title is actually a phrase in the song we're going to be talking about today. And before I begin, I would like to express my thanks to the Center for Creative Writing and Translation and the CMI Arts Initiative and CCWT's Srilata and Bharat for coordinating this event. I'd also like to make a dedication to a musician I have loved who passed away this past weekend of cancer. Her name is Connie Harris. She was somebody I met when I first went to Columbus and stood in for family. We all have those people in our lives when we go away to a different city and they are there for us. And she is one of the truest musicians and dare I say a poet who never practiced her art for any sort of gain in the world. And I'd just like to invoke that energy as I begin this talk. So why am I here today? Wait, 1 second. I just have to check that you can see my screen and hear me. Can you?
Yes. Okay. Yeah.
I just remembered that I forgot to share sound. So I will do that and then go back to sharing. Okay, you can see it now, right?
Yeah.
All right. So basically, I think I said this in the abstract. I'm really here because it's an exercise in self-indulgence. I adored music and poetry since I was a child. I can't imagine a world without either. That's one of the principal reasons I'm here in front of you. And also, Srilata, let me do this, which I really appreciate. And as she mentioned, I'm somebody who has slowly worked my way. Maybe I'm just a jack of all trades. I just like exploring new things and I like being the person who knows the least in a room. So I've gone around different disciplines being an ignoramus. And so I like to share, you know, those experiences of what I've learned from artists and writers and dancers and scholars who are so incredible and they've enriched my life. I wanted to talk a little bit about process, please note the pun, and in the hope that you will find something in what I say, maybe even just a sense of shared community in the struggles we face as scholars or artists or writers or poets in, you know, breaking new ground, finding something to say, you know, I hate this phrase, but, you know, sort of staying relevant in a fast-changing world. And that is always a struggle. It's both a struggle on the level of the individual. It's also a struggle for communities. And I just want to have the space to talk about that and hopefully, you know, catalyze some sort of discussion around that. And I'm really interested. I've knocked around and done a number of things, not very well, but what that has taught me is that you have to place yourself in a continuum or a spectrum, if you will, and think about how to transfer learnings from one domain to another. And your life is the richer, and I think all the communities you inhabit are the richer for those kinds of conversations. They're not what my mathematician friend Gaurav Rena calls conversations between unlike minds. Those are the most rewarding. And I think perhaps that's sort of a space that, you know, I'd like to inhabit myself. I also want to say, you know, I love poetry, but I'm not a poet. So any recommendations or experiences that I share they're not, you know, made by an expert. I'm in awe of poets. I mean, if I could be one, I would. I'm not really very good at it. But Doug and I really hope that perhaps even for, you know, people who have done this for a really long time, even the people I'm in awe of, I mean, sharing these experiences might trigger a different way of thinking about your craft. Or, you know, maybe just talking about it will help me think differently about mine and, you know, hearing Doug speak. I also wanted to say that I think every artist and writer I know, when we really reflect on what we do, we're full of questions about, you know, the world in which we live. The concerns of the world around you are always lapping at the edges of your individual experience, coloring them in myriad ways. And for me, making art, I mean, Shilata was very complimentary and I thank her for it, but for me, making art is just a means of survival. Also listening to music or reading poetry or looking at paintings or watching a great film, sometimes even just a really popular Netflix series, like the whatever, Ted Lasso, they give you something. They provide healing. Sometimes they make it okay to feel what you're feeling. Sometimes they provide great joy, laughter, and then sometimes they allow you to be distracted. And I think that's what art does. I mean, if you're an artist or you're appreciative of what artists and poets and writers do, you're looking at the craft, you're marveling at how they've taken a theme that's you resonated through the ages, but they've done something new with it. And that sometimes can allow you to take a break from your own travails. And you realize also that you're not alone. And I had to quote Pearl Jam, I'm still alive. That's the feeling I get when I absorb the great works of others. I've also found lately, I entered into theater for very different reasons. I felt very alive. I wanted to move away from the scholarly world into the practice of the body. So this was an experiment in sort of how do I, you know, go from writing about works of art to making that art myself. So that presented its own challenges. And I started doing this in my late 30s. But the music, I came back to it. I've been on and off involved in music and I'm trained a little bit in music, but a rebel, so I didn't really finish my training. So in December 2018, I found that I was writing songs just to deal with you know, and I have this book in front of me of the trauma of everyday life. I don't know if you can see, I think it's the opposite way, but it's Mark Epstein's book, which Sheelata introduced me to, and I've just started reading, but I love that phrase. And I think we were talking about it the other day at work. And I think that that's what it does for me, the ability to write a few poems diffidently and, you know, write some songs with marginally more courage with Doug, who's, you know, with me every step of the way. I think what it does is help me deal with the trauma of everyday life. And I'm hoping that talking about it will also help me reflect on this and write, you know, reflectively about this in a larger project. So before we move into the song in which we're going to share some notes on process, I'd like to sort of, since if there are students here, I invite you to read this particular piece by Edward Hirsch. Oops, I need to go back. In which on the Poetry Foundation website, where he makes some claims. It's a very charming quote unquote essay. He's pushing the envelopes when it comes to genre. And he makes some claims about what the poem, what poetry does. It's very lovely and whimsical, but at the same time, true. It rings true in terms of my own experience. And what I love about what Hirsch says is about the what he calls the immense intimacy and the intimate immensity of poetry. You really feel like a voice is speaking to you across space and sometimes time, and that's what I really love about it. I also like the points he makes about how poetry rests you out of your habitual experience of language, defamiliarizes. I think this is a word that's used by the Prague school, and it's called estrangement by the Russian formalists, people who deal with form. They talk about the fact that poets are experts at taking something you know and putting it in a completely different context, and using words in fresh ways. Of course, Wordsworth and Coleridge also talked about this, the romantic poets. But it's something that's so important because it keeps language fresh. It you know, paves the way for creativity and fresh thinking. And I love the way Hirsch talks about muscular, how a poem is a muscular and composed thing. I like to think about embodiment, because we always think of these, you know, the act of writing as an activity of the mind. And we, you know, don't pay attention to how we embody language through writing. And I like this idea of the muscular composed thing that moves like a wave, dissolving the literal. So it's a gateway into the figurative. And just wanted to quickly take us to this poem called Sunshower. For anyone who hasn't heard this term, it's when I think the sun is shining and it rains, and it's called a sun shower. And there is a little bit of context that, you know, there's an American saying that, you know, when there's a sun shower, the devil is beating his wife. So just to, you know, think about all these ideas of Hirsch, I'll just read this poem aloud, and you can think about how. This is one of my favorite poets. She's also from Ohio State, Natalie Shapiro. You know, how this poem works to do some of the things Hirsch says it does. Some people say the devil is beating his wife. Some people say the devil is pawing his wife. Some people say the devil is doubling down on an overall attitude of entitlement toward the body of his wife. Some people say the devil won't need to be sorry, as the devil believes that nothing comes after this life. Some people say that in spite of the devil's public, longstanding, and meticulously logged disdain for the health and wholeness of his wife, the devil spends all day, every day, insisting grandly and gleefully on his general pro-woman ethos, that the devil truly considers himself to be an unswayed crusader, effortlessly magnetic, scrupulous, gracious, and in spite of the devil's several advanced degrees, a luminous autodidact. Some people say, calm down, this is commonplace. Some people say, calm down, this is very rare. Some people say the sun is washing her face. Some people say in hell, they're having an affair. So I don't know how to go back. So I'm not going to say anything about that because I think it will sort of get us, into the realm of analytics and professorial gobbledygook. And so I'll just let you enjoy that poem and some of the stuff that Hirsch said about the power of poetry and move on to thinking about music. And this is the very famous Oliver Sacks in his book, Musicophilia, expert on all of this. He says music can pierce the heart directly. It needs no mediation. One does not have to know anything about Dido and Aeneas to be moved by her lament for him. Anyone who has ever lost someone knows what Dido is expressing. And there is finally a deep and mysterious paradox here. For while such music makes one experience pain and grief more intensely, it brings solace and consolation at the same time. And so I know that this feeling of the therapeutic or cathartic effects of music that I was feeling when I was making music. And when I listen to music, I'm not alone in feeling this. The experts feel it too. And I love this because it's love how Sacks goes, you know, to the Aeneid, to the epic. And to the intercutting, interconnected, interleaved worlds of literature, poetry, you know, epic poetry and music. And for a second, I just wanted to play maybe 30 seconds of this Dido's Lament by the English composer Henry Purcell, which is sung by a musician I love, Annie Lennox. This is what Annie Lennox says about interpreting Dido's Lament, the same piece that Sacks is talking about. She says, it occurred to me that there was a comparison to the destruction human beings have brought upon the planet between, you know, the epic story of Dido, you know, brokenhearted, taking her own life when Aeneas leaves in the Aeneid. And so then she says, when it comes to climate catastrophe, we are on the edge of the abyss. I see Dido's lament as a lament for our dying planet. So I'll just play a little bit of this for you to get a flavor of what Annie Lennox is doing here.
I don't think we can hear it clearly, Akhila.
Even I can't hear it clearly.
Yeah.
No, we cannot hear it. It's breaking up.
We can't hear at all, actually.
Oh dear. I can just keep moving. I did share sound. I don't know what happened. Because usually, okay, let me try once more and then we'll see if that works. It's not letting me share sound. Okay, never mind. I'll just not share sound. There's some permission that's not working here. Okay, so maybe I'll just paste this link, or you can look it up, Annie Lennox's version of Dido's Lament, and listen to it yourself. But to think about how, you know, something can ripple through time across genres and, you know, still animate the musical and artistic worlds of artists today. And Annie Lennox is a popular musician of today. There's another beautiful version of Dido's Lament by another rock musician, Jeff Buckley. And of course, there are thousands of classical versions of this. So anyway, I'll keep going. Move to the next slide. So now I'll get more to what I promised. I mean, the abstract promise this talk would be about, and it is about stages in the songwriting process. And I may or may not have this right. Doug can correct me, but as has been identified, I think, by musicians today who record music in recording studios, there's about six stages to the songwriting process. And, you know, it really helps to realize this. I didn't think about this in 2018 when we started recording songs. This way, when I finished writing a song, I mean, at least the vocal melody and the lyrics, I thought the work was done. I have an inkling, I've done some studio work, but I didn't realize how laborious each of these stages can be, because I had been more of a live musician before this and done, you know, very little studio recording. So if you look at this, these six stages, they're incredibly messy. Sometimes you go back, change things. Often after a song is arranged and the initial recording of a voice has happened, that's called a scratch track. So you go back and re-record, sometimes in response to what has happened in the studio, some freshness or some idea that occurred to you. So this does not happen in a linear fashion. There's lots of going back and forth between stage one and stage six. Well, you can't go back after mastering, I think, unless you're willing to spend a bunch of money. But there's a lot of going back and forth between stages one and five. And while this might sound a bit technical, it's all new knowledge for me since December 2018. I'd like to say is that I wanted to share this this sort of newfound rudimentary knowledge I have of this process with other people who are engaged in processes of their own. Composing, producing, you know, making stuff. I didn't put production here, but you know, that's another thing to think about. Whether it's in the performing arts or in the domain of, you know, scholarship or any other field that exists in the world today, I think what working with very defined, you know, stages through which a particular thing you're creating moves, it really changes how you look at everything you do in other places as well. For instance, I feel like I honor collaborators' roles. So if I hadn't been doing this, and if I published, a book of essays, I think, I wouldn't realize, I mean, it would take me a long time to realize how important other people who do the work to put your book out there, how important that work is. And now I've got a newfound respect for the things that other people do to make a thing. And also to realize that even things that you think of as solitary, like poetry or writing, are not that solitary. In the sciences, I don't think you have this problem. And you know, the knowledge that knowledge making is collaborative is very clearly established in the way you publish, in the way you produce, in the way you present. It's been that way through centuries. But sometimes in the arts and the humanities, I think we celebrate the myth of the sole author, despite, you know, Barthes and Foucault's notes on who or what an author is. And but when you in your embodied practice encounter the fact that you're not doing this alone, and there's so many other forces and other people who help you along the way, it's really, really helpful. It also helps me think beyond that first draft. I think sometimes we give the act of writing, drafting, way more importance than we do editing. Seasoned writers know this, but I think going into writing after experiencing songwriting, it helps me prioritize better, create a timeline better beyond the initial drafting. Defamiliarizes that experience, makes me look at it in a different way, just as poetry defamiliarizes language for us. So now let me get to one song and talk, you know, make this scenario and these stages real for you with the help of my collaborator, Doug. It's a song I wrote in, I think, the third week of January of this year, which just came back from mastering. And that's fast for us, I think. But this, for some reason, we were very quick this time. But it's a song that I wrote the lyrics for initially. The song is written by both me and Doug. And it explores this metaphor of kintsugi, which means joining with gold. I think Geetanjali will know much more about this than I do. It's a form of Japanese ceramic repair. And you know, it was one of those days where I was just going down a rabbit hole. I'd read some of Basho's haiku, and that, you know, it's machine learning and the algorithm was taking me all kinds of places. So I jumped around and I, you know, started looking at these beautiful objects. I think if I hover over this, it might. No, it's not doing it. Anyway, so the, you know, it's sort of these, maybe I can go there and come back. It's this sort of thing where when a piece of, a ceramic bowl or an urn breaks, you know, it's joined together with this lacquer that's dipped in gold. And one of those extremely gray and sorrowful days, I think this sort of swam into my consciousness as something that I wanted to think about in terms of a song, how, you know, this metaphor, this was sort of pre actually verbalizing. I wasn't saying any of this stuff. This was all in my thoughts. And somehow I ended up writing this song, which was describing a kintsugi bowl that didn't exist. I mean, I'd looked at hundreds of them on the internet, but you know, I was trying to put one together, and that bowl somehow was representing, you know, my ability to piece my life back together. You know, I realized what I was doing is ekphrasis. So that is the kind of poem that describes a work of visual art. Sometimes the work is actual. Sometimes it is, you know, so Tom Gunn has a poem about the conversion of Saul. It's a Caravaggio painting from the Renaissance. But Keats has a fictional poem. It's Ode on a Grecian Urn. So it's a fictional urn. I mean, there are fragments of the Parthenon that you can see in the British Museum that seem to be scenes that Keats is describing from the urn, but they're not on an urn. So I mean, I've loved and taught that poem for many, many years. And then of course, before ekphrasis came to mean a poem that describes a visual image or a work of art, it just meant vivid description, I guess. And there's a very famous passage in the Iliad where Achilles' shield is described, and that's also seen as ekphrasis. So I know all this stuff, you know, because, you know, I teach literature and that's all I've known for a very long time. But then how do you write? I mean, it's one thing to be a scholar of this stuff, but how do you actually write a poem about the shattered object that is your life? How melodramatic, anyway, you know what I mean. But you know, you've knocked around long enough, there are some breaks, you're putting them back together. How do you do honor to all your experiences, and how do you still get a sense of the beauty of those experiences? And how can you write a song? Now we've added not only words, but we're thinking about music as well. How do you write a song that encompasses this metaphor in some way or does justice to this metaphor, which I have very rudimentary knowledge of? So I sort of have to make it more about my inner experience and less about, you know, the Japanese art of kintsugi. I'm just being a magpie and a thief. When something is attractive, I'm trying to use it just to get by and, you know, deal with the trauma of everyday life. So it distracts me from, you know, that trauma to actually shaping it into something that is potentially sort of beautiful. So that's the idea. So what can one do? There are all these things you think about, words, mood, music, and you know, so, you know, you start with, and you know, all these stages are going to come ahead when you're writing a song. So you're not just writing the lyrics. So then this is what I did. I'll take you to the actual lyrics and then I'll hand over to Doug. So these are the lyrics of the song. I will say only that I tried in the feel of the lyrics and the melody to give a sense of fragments. So I didn't want to have too many repetitions, but I, you know, I didn't want any verse to sound the same as the next one. I wanted it to have this, you know, aspect of jaggedness, the song itself. But at the same time, I didn't want to take the metaphor too literally. You know, it's like there's a musician, a jazz pianist, Vijay Iyer, I think he did something on the Fibonacci sequence, and he talks about this, like you can't take the numbers too literally, you can't take the math too literally, you have to imbibe the principle. So I guess reading about that helped me here. So what I did was, so there, you know, there are some repetitions in the song. So I worked on doing something which went off into a different aspect of my consciousness and different fragments, but none of it was really this thought through. This is all in hindsight. When I was actually writing it, it was much messier and uglier, the process. So this is the song. What brings you here? Why do you linger near? Lost eyes stare into space. When your heart breaks, do you just disappear? Pick up pieces of pace. So that's sort of bringing the metaphor to life. And then there's this bit, where do we belong? This relentless march in a gathering throng of thieves and cheats, creeps and deadbeats, deceit complete, no place to retreat. So I was playing also with rhyme, with assonance, which is, you know, making the similar vowel sounds, even if the words don't rhyme. Why do I care? They got off scot-free. How do they dare? How is it fair? Listen, world, stop messing with me. That is one fragment. Goes back to where do we belong, this relentless march in a gathering throng of thieves and cheats, creeps and deadbeats, aching weary feet, no place to retreat, the few replete, but the many have little to eat, and hell is that terrible song that plays endlessly on repeat, but good soldiers never admit defeat. And then there's another section, so that's its own fragment. Chug along, plant a bomb, wing a song with aplomb, bang a gong, thwack a tom, that's a tribute to Doug, right or wrong, always remember, hug your mom, always remember you're strong. I want to give this impression of a good soldier walking along. And then the big question, where do you belong? What's it to be, cake or eternity? Which words do we efface? The fragments we hold, jagged, rimmed with gold, lock finally in place. I wanted to create a sense of closure there. And then we come back to where do we belong? This was Doug's idea, actually, that we should finish it off with that. And it ends on this note, the few replete, but the many have little to eat, because that I thought was a way to bring back the world that is lapping at the edge of the individual experience, so it doesn't become an exercise in self-indulgence. So with that, I will hand over to Doug. He's one of my dearest friends, somebody I met many, many decades ago, I think, a rock drummer. He's a multi-instrumentalist now. He's the mixing engineer, so he mixes all of our songs. He does many other things besides. And oops, let me go back to that slide. And he's played the drums, the guitars, the bass, and the synths on Kintsugi and mixed the song. And I'll hand over to him. Doug.
Thanks. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Hi all. That was all, it's all interesting to me, Akhila, to listen to you go through that process. I think, you know, sometimes maybe you and I talk about a song and what's inspired it for you, and I can kind of play off of that. And sometimes we just really don't. And I think this actually was one where we didn't, as I recall. Yeah?
Yeah, we didn't talk much about it. Did I even give you the lyrics?
I think you did send me the lyrics, but we didn't like really talk about your process. But right. Yeah. I mean, if I can start by throwing a compliment her way, despite the name of your talk here, one thing that Akhila never sends me, I would say, is like fragments of a song. Like it always seems very, like pretty done, like composed, you know, and I'm a structural thinker as a, as a drummer, and like, so I feel like that's something I could be good at, but I don't ever have to mess with it too much. I think just looking at other people's songwriting process, I think people tend to start with little fragments of things and they just try and mix and match things and see what works. And I hear what she's talking, you know, there's some repeated parts in this song, but she's trying not to be too repeated, and it really develops really nicely. But like, she has never sent me anything that I wouldn't call a complete song. So that really, like, I mean, that makes my job really easy, because we're not like trying to cobble something together necessarily. Like, it, you know, this song in particular, like, yeah, I mean, obviously, like, the meter is there, the key is there, like, so many things that sort of inform the vibe of the piece are like already kind of there. Like, this one is basically like in three. Like, I hear it as it's like a blues, which I think makes sense, you know, with what she has said about, you know, where she was coming from writing this song. But you know, I still hesitate as I sit here today to call myself a songwriter, but so it's really fun to have her. She's really sort of heard the song. Like, she's not an instrumentalist, she's a great writer, but she knows music well enough too that, like, it really is, she's done the hard part. Like, I just have to kind of find the chords and the instrumentation and all that, make all that work once she sends me something. So that's really fun for me, because it's been a great gateway for me into songwriting, because if I had to like come up with something from scratch, that's just not what I do, not what I'm particularly good at. But it's great to like just have like sort of a really well-formed idea that just isn't completely realized yet. It needs all the instrumentation and whatever, but it's just a really fun place for me to start what she hands me. So I guess what, is that your memory of it, though, Akhila? I really don't think we talked about this one too much, but like hearing you talk about it, like, since then and now, like, I hope we hit this one on the head. I mean, I really heard it as kind of a blues.
I think so. Yeah, right? I don't know if I didn't like it. We go way back. Yeah.
So, here, I'll share my screen now. I will share sound. Sorry. So, go ahead.
Sorry, I just wanted to say that the fact that you and I have very similar musical tastes, but also widely divergent tastes, and sounds helps, because we have a common language, but we're also constantly introducing each other to things I think that are out of each other's ken in some sense. Yeah. Sorry.
Yeah, for sure. And I think, you know, because we're of a, I'm gonna stop this for a second, because we're of a certain age, I feel like we reference a lot of like 90s things that, you know, from our formative years and from the years where we were together here in Columbus. So for this one, yeah, like I was hearing this sort of bluesy, almost churchy sort of vibe. But one thing I've been trying to do with production, this is just kind of, I'm really, you know, I'm new. I've been around music production for years, but I haven't been the engineer until the last few years doing this stuff with Akhila. So like, I'm just in a period of just soaking things up. I'm watching other people work and I'm just trying a lot of things. And though, like, you know, bass, drums, guitar kind of music is my sweet spot, that's what I'm familiar with. Like, I've been kind of trying to play with things that are leaning a little more towards modern kind of electronic music stuff. And so like I was watching some producers do some things, and I definitely borrowed some ideas for this song that I think ended up working really well. But one of them was this like sort of organ sound. Again, sounds like a church blues sort of thing, and it ended up working really well with this one. So anyways, she does her thing. She sends me, again, a fairly well-formed song, and I just have to kind of look at it structurally and find the chords and then the instrumentation to bring it to life. And so I have here, let me share again here. So I have the first recording that she sent me, actually. So this often will just start with like a voice memo or something. That's basically what this is. So let me just play that for you real quick. A little bit of it.
What brings you here? Why do you linger near? Lost eyes staring to space. And when your heart breaks,
can hear all the street sounds
do you
and everything.
Just disappear? Or pick up pieces of pace. Where do we belong? A relentless marching, a gathering throng.
So okay, so that's what she sent me initially, and that's what I start working with. And then she did a second one pretty quickly after that, where she's using the same software that I'm using, Logic Pro. She can usually records to the tempura for tuning, and usually we record these to a click, to like a grid. Not always. In retrospect, I kind of maybe think we should have just done this one free time. If it would have been a good one for that, but usually it's recorded to a click, and so she'll send me that, and then I can really start layering things in. And so basically I just take the melody that she sends me. First thing I do, like, the guitar is sort of my main non-percussive instrument. I don't play keys very well. And so I'll sit with the guitar and I'll just figure out her melody, figure out what the key is, and then just start playing with chords. Where do I hear the chords? What are they? And then like messing around with voicing the chords different ways. And so we basically almost always end up with a sort of traditional singer-songwriter kind of acoustic guitar and vocal thing first, and then I kind of decide what to do with instrumentation. So an example of that would be this. This was like an early just guitar vocal version. Let me just skip forward here a little bit.
This relentless margin, a gathering throng of thieves and cheats, creeps and deadbeats, deceit, defeat, no place to retreat.
So that's kind of where we started. That's almost always what happens. And then I end up in my software here, just trying to figure out how to bring all that to life, like style wise again, what do we want to do? And like a lot of the style and vibe of this, again, I think was just embedded in what she gave me. But the first sound again that I kind of jumped on was this kind of organ sound. Let me see. I don't know if anybody out there has any experience with synths and things. I'm using soft synths, you know, these are just like software versions of synths. Hardware synths are incredibly expensive. They're ridiculously expensive. So this is a very common thing. I don't have it set up right now, but I've got a MIDI keyboard. It's just a controller for these like software synth emulations. And so this Vox synth is an actual hardware synth. This is an emulation of, and this is just sort of a, that's not it. This is kind of the sound I was drawn to. So it starts with this little swell, and then you can kind of hear it playing the chords. I'll just play a little bit of this. And so I liked the churchy organ sound of that. There is a bunch of processing on it. You can hear it's got like a little like old style like tape warble to it. I think especially considering like the theme of the song, like it's a little rough around the edges. It's a little creepy sounding almost. And then there were a number of other like synth type instruments that come in later. There's a Prophet is a really common synth for the last few decades I used in the pre-chorus here, this kind of thing. So this ended up being a lot of, you know, traditional bass drums guitar like I'm used to doing, but it's got this kind of great synthy drone to it. And again, you know, she's almost always sending me vocals with the tempura in there, and I'm just so used to hearing that drone, it's kind of become our thing a little bit. that I'm always looking for some kind of drone instrument that sort of mimics that without being that, you know, and I think the synth kind of does that nicely. So it started with a guitar, kind of came up with the chords, and then instead of having it on the guitar right at the beginning, it's mostly the synth. And then I tracked, I've been playing with drum samples a lot, which is a little weird for me as a drummer. Like, I normally like to play drums, but I did a little bit of a combination of things in this song, but it's mostly acoustic drums with a little bit of electronic trickery here and there, but the live drums sounded like this. It's pretty simple. It's really just kind of laying down the pulse. And one of the things that Akhila liked that I did here was a little gimmicky, is there's this shaker sound in here, which I did with a dollar bill. I just took a dollar bill and went in this mic that I'm using here, just kind of rubbing the dollar bill together as a shaker sound. Sounds like this. And then like affected a bunch of ways. So like, to me, like the synth pad and the drum sound is just a big part of this song. And then eventually I did include the acoustic guitar like I initially had. I just didn't start the song. I kind of like the vibe of having it like really kind of austere and minimal at the beginning, and eventually that acoustic guitar does show up. And so like the chorus, you can hear the guitars. This is where the acoustic guitar enters. With me. And then let's see. So there, one guitar trick I'm really fond of in here. There's a bunch of electric guitars in here too, that are just playing really simple. There's not a whole lot going on in here. It's really, this song is very soundscapey to me. And one of the really soundscapey things I like to do with electric guitars is different delay effects. In this case, there's a reverse delay effect, which, by the way, we were speaking of our song Walking earlier. And that song has a lot of reverse delay. It takes, like, you play something, and this, I'm doing this with a guitar pedal that I have just off camera here. You probably can't see it, but I can also do it in software. You play something, and it takes that signal, and it reverses it, and then sort of repeats it. And it's just sort of a fun effect. It kind of sounds, you should be able to hear it here, like this. So there's a whole bunch of that reverse guitar in this song throughout. That's just kind of a fun vibey thing that works nicely with these synths in there. So that's, you know, it's basically these synth pads are, but there's some other, like, I did not just the synths, but there is a little bit of, where is it? I did some soft synth violins in here. There's some strings. When we're able to, we have someone actually play live strings for us, which is great. But sometimes I'll use these MIDI synths in here. So there's a bunch of textural elements like that in there. But that's basically it. You know, it's like guitars, the synths, the drums. The chords are very similar across a lot of that instrumentation, just voicing things different, and I'm bringing things in and out here and there, and there's a whole lot of like processing on it. So it's really more vibe than anything. I'm just kind of trying to, you know, create a feeling coming in and out of these sections with all this processing. So like once I have all that instrumentation sort of recorded, and like she said earlier, I go back and forth between all these processes a lot. Like, you come up with a part, you record something, you mix it, and you go back. I might re-record something, or I have a different idea. I record the same part on a different instrument, process it. So this might all look really cryptic to you looking at the software, but all the, you know, each one of these channels down here is a different instrument, and there's a bunch of individual processing, EQ, compression, all kinds of like time-based effects, reverbs, delays. Again, I did a lot of that like old like tape machine kind of warping sounds, just making everything sound a little bit off kilter, you know, throughout the song, just for a particular kind of vibe. And so a lot of my time is just spent getting the balance of all the instruments and figuring out how to process things in an interesting way. And then as best as I can, getting the instruments out of the way of one another, so they're all sort of distinct in the mix. But hopefully, you know, this one, you know, Akhila and I talk a lot about, like, a lot of our songs end up being really dense sounding. I'm hoping this one's not that way. I'm not playing a whole lot in the song. It's hopefully just a lot of vibe and very, you know, focused on the vocal. So I don't know, should I play a little bit of more of this, Akhila, maybe?
Maybe like a minute of the song so people can get a flavor of it, maybe towards the end, from Chug Along or around that part.
Yeah, the little bridge. So yeah. Akhila, you know, the bridge is sort of a dying part of songwriting. A lot of pop music these days is just verse, chorus. She's real good at, you know, sticking with having a traditional bridge after a chorus. It really mixes things up. And this is, I think I'm in the right place. This is what that bridge sounded like coming back to a verse, I think.
I think the volume is down.
Is it? It's what? Yeah. Can you hear it okay?
Yeah, it's fine now.
Okay.
Good soldiers never admit defeat. Along, brought a bomb, wing a song with a plum, bang a gong, whack a tom, fight a rock. Always remember, hug your mom. Always remember, you're strong. Had you ever wrong? What's it to be?
That reminds me, we didn't talk about your vocal harmonies and stuff in here. So we went through, and that's okay. Do you want to hear them real quick or no?
That's fine. They can hear them, I think. Yeah.
They say here real quick. So that we went through a couple of iterations of this main vocal, and the one I ended up using was one of the first ones she did, you know, and that's often the way it goes. Like, before you've thought about it too much, just lay it down. That ends up being a really good take. But then she did go back into the studio and record a bunch of harmonies. So here's a couple
of those.
Which
words do we efface? So, the clock finally is.
And the chorus.
Where do we belong? This relentless marching, a gathering throng of thieves and cheats, creeps and deadbeats.
So kind of some high parts and some low parts arranged, you know, that's what's really gives it a lot of depth and dimension. But so yeah, what else, Akhila? We want to give people a chance to maybe ask questions.
Yeah, I think so. I think we can just stop here. I had some summing up, but I can share the slides for people to think about later if they want them.
Thank you.
Do you stop there?
Questions or comments, anyone?
So do you ever go back to the song itself after this process of setting it to music and song? Do you say, okay, I need to revise my song? Does that happen also?
Should I answer?
I mean, I think that's for you. Yeah, we really haven't done that yet, I don't think, with any of these songs. But I don't know. Yeah, Akhila, do you at least desire to go back and do that ever?
No, I think, you know, rock music is more forgiving than academia in these sorts of things. And you sort of think about these things as, you know, a snapshot in time, you know, and just a reflection of where you're at. It's just a, you know, it just marks where you were in your journey. We talk a lot about that, actually. I think there are some things we've gotten better at. And this is all part of our learning. So, you know, you sort of feel like you're just learning still. But also, Doug and I are in an unusual place. We lived in the same city for 15 years and never once did we play music together. We were such good friends. We both had our own projects. So we started working together. You know, poor Mara has had to deal with me as a virtual roommate, I think, in their apartment since we started working together in 2019. So we've actually only collaborated remotely. We have never played these songs in the same room together. So I'm hoping to go this year and actually sit down with Doug and for us to actually play these songs together. So in that
We're not sure we know how to do that even.
How to do that. Because, you know, but they're just these exercises in sort of creativity and, you know, exploring something for each of us, I think. And I have been singing them live a little bit here with another of our collaborators, Vedant Paradwaj, but so that's been happening a little bit, but not very much. But
it's super fun for me. I mean, I always was a drummer, mostly dabbled with other things, and I was always kind of trying to envision like what different sort of relationship I could have to music. And so it's great to be doing all this, but yeah, kind of learning as we're going. I mean, I still second guess everything that I do. So like, I want to go back and redo everything we've done, but yeah, it's a moment in time. At some point you let it go and you move forward, but she writes such great stuff. Like, it's like, I always want to make the most of every tune. Sometimes they're hard to let go of, but yeah, it's a moment in time. And I know she's going to keep sending me stuff. So.
You know, this is actually the first time I've ever heard Doug say it. He likes the stuff I write.
I'm a tough audience too. Like, I mean, just with commercial music, like, there isn't a ton of stuff that I really like. And I think there is really good melody. I know you're thinking through things. It's all very well thought out, and musically it works really well, and it's just super fun for me. Yeah, she'll tell you, like, I'm the first person to sort of doubt my own abilities sometimes or whatever, but I feel like the end result with all this, like, I feel like it's pretty good work. I'm not sure exactly how we're doing it, but it's certainly a fun process for us, and I think we're certainly getting better and better at it as we go, I hope. And that Mara confirms that for me on occasion, which is encouraging. my wife who's here with us.
Well, yeah, the songs will be released soon. So if anybody's interested, I'll pass on the links to Srilata, and maybe you can send it to people who want to hear them in about a month. We're going to put
the... We should talk about the name, like, where we've been waffling about what we're going to call this, because we've rebranded it from what we were doing before, which was Akhila and the Alchemist. That was kind of a different project. So the things that her and I are doing together, just the two of us, is a little different. So new name, we think it's going to be called Starcracker, right?
Yeah,
I thought about calling it, I wanted to call it Day is Night at first. I made that joke earlier because, you know, it's morning here, it's evening there. Like, I send her mixes in the evening as I'm going to bed. She listens to when she first gets up. There were some other things we liked about it, but it just says a lot about the way we work. And, you know, it's, you know, things in the world, everything's, it has a little bit of an upside down world feeling, which seems timely too. And so that might end up being the name of the EP though, instead of the project. And Starcracker.
Mahalakshmi, I think, has a question in the chat box.
Okay.
I think it's Logic, correct?
Yeah. So yeah, the DAW I'm using, that's the digital audio workstation, the software. I'm in Logic at the moment. I maybe the Pro Tools is the kind of industry standard these days. I mean, they're both very common. I've been in Logic to now. I might be in Pro Tools going forward, but yeah, that was Logic that you were looking at. And Akhila has it as well, and kind of demos things in Logic.
Yeah. Usha, please ask.
Yeah. No, first of all, it was such a wonderful session. Thanks so much, Srilata. Only, so mesmerizing. Only I felt it was too short. We could really go on and on. The question I wanted to ask is, talking about poetry and poem and song, I just wanted to your comments on the use of song in poetic plays, where there's poetry galore, but I mean, Shakespeare, for instance, he introduces a song in some very dramatic scenes. So like, for instance, in The Merchant of Venice.
Yes.
And he's making the choice of the caskets. There's a music, yeah. A song in the background.
Yeah.
So, be the dramatic relevance of such an introduction?
Sorry, what's
the dramatic relevance in introducing a song in a drama which is full of poetry otherwise?
Yeah, I think it just it picks up the pace and movement, and of course it has to be true to that situation. I love Ariel's song in The Tempest. That's really beautiful. It sort of brings that sort of ethereal, otherworldly dimension to this darker tale. I think, you know, there's musicals. That's an entire genre in itself. I'm a theater actor too, so I've used song, and then not. I mean, depending on the play that we're doing. So I think they're there for very specific purposes, just like the play within the play or any other genre. The soliloquy. I think they're there to heighten whatever mood and theme is being played out in the moment. Mm. I don't think there's a one size fits all answer to that. I could be wrong. I'm not a Shakespeare scholar. If you want Shakespeare,
I'd read an expression that it anesthetizes the critical sense at some point.
Yeah, I
don't know.
I think it does the opposite. I think it awakens the senses. I think felt sense, that's what Sandra Pearl talks about when it comes to writers. I think that, you know, you get in touch with felt sense, and, you know, it brings you into tune with the universe, I think, music. I mean, I love both, but, you know, the power of music is, I mean, Jamshed this year, he's a neuroscientist and a violinist. Doug, I think we could persuade him to play for free, our vice chancellor. so you could just send him your
thank you. That was lovely.
I'll go record him. So, but anyway, you do have your violin here, don't you, Jamshed? But I mean, maybe your thoughts on what, you know, what music does for the brain would be useful here.
Thank you, but I will, this is your talk. I'm more interested in what you have to say.
Okay, fine. Pass, I guess. Okay.
Akhila, I had a quick question.
Yes.
And this is not specific to your collaboration with Doug, but it's a more sort of a universal question about collaboration itself, right? And I completely agree, and I see your point about how not just how valuable it is in terms of the work that comes out, but also how it teaches you how those moving parts work and what everybody does. And I think it's for me also as a writer to even see what somebody in the publishing house does with it, or who the proofreader does with the book, and how they see the book and how it becomes a book. It's just fascinating, the cover, all of that, right?
Even
and
book. I've done,
oh gosh, no, it's not about me. Yeah. But you know, there are times when very often what you want to do is just to listen to your own voice so you can do your thing and be heard. Is there a downside to collaboration, is I guess what I'm asking, because sometimes when you're working with somebody else, irrespective of the synergies and all of that, do you ever feel, have you ever felt, and not, as I said, not specifically a Doug, but a time when, you just want to kind of do your thing and be the solitary artist, and not have to be pulled into having to listen to a different voice, because that's, sometimes it feels like that, no? When you, and sometimes, I'm saying not always, but just curious about that.
Well, Doug can also answer this question because he's been in a very well-known touring band of regional distinction and so on and so forth, and so he's worked with collaborators for a very long time, more than I have perhaps in that sort of in the musical arena, but my answer to this is I think then you're with the wrong kind of collaborators. I think, and also it's very rare to find the right kind of collaborator. I think the fact that my friendship with Doug predates, I mean, these are the rational explanations I have for why it works well, and I shouldn't jinx it, I'm touching wood as I speak, but us knowing each other so well helps us be very frank with each other. We can sort of dispense with the niceties to some extent. So sometimes I'll send a, usually it's Doug dispensing with the niceties. Like I said something and he's like, no, I'm just gonna just a no to whatever suggestion I made. But I know I'm kidding. I also, you know, protest strenuously about certain things. And we can be frank with each other. But at the same time, there's tremendous respect and regard. I mean, we're two people who've been through lots of stuff, I mean, in our individual lives. So we're happy when the other person's happy and sad when the other person's sad. So, I mean, I think that really helps. And also trust, right? I mean, underneath all of that soft stuff, you know, I mean, all of that could have backfired so easily. I mean, the minute we started collaborating, we could have been great friends and then been terrible collaborators. But I think the experience of listening together and building that collaboration without realizing it, we've spent hours together listening to songs. And I think Doug shares that with Mara as well. She comes from a musical family and she's a wonderful dancer. She's actually done a little bit of dancing for one of our songs a long time ago. And I hope she'll do it again. But I think surrounding yourself with people with whom you're building these creative relationships and sharing ideas and sharing trust. And so that when you're coming to the table with just the collaboration, that's not the only thing you're doing. You're discovering worlds together and you're allowing the other person to wander off and do their thing. So trust, letting go, being open, also not micromanaging. Like, but you can't not micromanage if you don't trust the person. That's the bind, right? Because you're hovering anxiously because it's your work. But with Doug, I just give it to him and I don't worry about it. And, you know, I mean, to the point that sometimes in the scratch track, the first tracks that I sent, he'll manipulate the note because it'll go better with the chord. And, you know, with somebody else, I might take umbrage, like, who are you to change a note in my, you know? But when it's done, I'm like, yeah, I mean, it makes so much more sense. It goes with the song. And I just go sing it that way. We never talk about this. I mean, this is the first time I've actually opened my mouth and said something about it. Like, I mean, in the beginning, he'd joke that, you know, I've pushed things around. But I'd say, haha, and then I'd just go sing it exactly how he pushed it. So, I mean, to that extent, but now we don't even talk about that, like whatever happens. And also, like when I go back to record and I do these harmonies, I know we're out of time, but I'll just spend 1 minute because this is something I really wanted to say. Editing, I mean, Doug is one of the most fabulous editors and, you know, editors are writers, I think. I mean, it's slightly different when you're an individual author of a book, but in a musical, you know, those hats are, you know, they work in certain ways in certain fields. But I really feel like, you know, I'll send him every possible harmony I can think of. I mean, there's songs in which, you know, I'll just send him as much stuff as possible. Like there'll be vocals stacked on vocals, about 6 vocals, right? Different layers, thirds, fifths, whatever came to my mind at the moment, in addition to the stuff I already plan when I go into a recording studio. And sometimes he'll compress it all, or it's just there really wet in the background. You can barely hear it. But then, you know, if you actually hear the raw vocals from the recording, there'll be like 6 voices jumping out. You know, it sounds like Queen, if you ever heard that band, you know, but just me doing overdubs of my own voice. But I completely trust his ability to finish a song. And I never once have thought, oh, he's taken those things out. Like, I just don't. It's just the way the process works between us. I mean, I think Mara can attest to this also, that there's hardly any of that kind of friction. It's really easy that way.
Yeah, it's great to have good collaborators. I mean, there's definitely a balance to be struck. Like, I love to do my own thing, but I'm limited to what I'm capable of doing on my own. And like, I mean, this is a great example. I said earlier, like, I'm not sure I ever would have tried to write and produce my own stuff, like, without you know content that you're creating, you know, to get it rolling or whatever. Like, I wouldn't be doing this without your contribution, which is huge. You know, that's the hard part. So yeah, I've been spoiled to have really good collaborators over the years. And as a professional, I'm a video producer, and like, I'm so tired of like one man banding everything in that part of my life too. It's just I like to collaborate where the sum of the parts is greater than what you would have been able to do otherwise. So yeah, it's nice to have your alone time to dig in and not have any time constraints or anything, just focus on what you do, but doing it in the context of a collaborative project where, you know, it's gonna be something that you couldn't have done on your own.
Right, I think.
So any more questions? Yeah.
I'm so excited Gitanjali Rajan is here. She writes amazing haiku. I think she's the most amazing person.
Awesome. We're going to have her for at one of our CCW.
Oh my God, you have to, and I'll be here with
absolutely. I've already reached out to her. So.
Like, she'll send me something and I just look at it for hours. Like, how did she do that? You know, and I think that's why we're all in this, you know? I mean, that's why sharing is such a huge thing. I mean, it's just like, how did he come up with, I mean, like the wonder of that, you know, in collaboration is just miraculous. Like, you, somebody else can come up with something you never could on your own.
It gives me like tremendous confidence too, just in like, you know, it's like, again, it's like so easy to like second guess what you do, but you see what you contribute to a thing collaboratively and what it turns into, and it's like, oh, I can do, like, Akhila's always pushing me in directions that I'm really uncomfortable with, and it always turns out better than I might think it would be, and then it's like, oh, okay, and then you just have a little more confidence going into it next time, and it just gets better and better, and you keep trying newer and bigger and better things all the time. It's great.
May I say something? I mean, yes, thanks, Srilata. So the thing is, I think across the last 2-3 years, I've been getting the raw version of Akhila's songs, and I kind of listen to it and along with the lyrics, and then after a few, you know, sometimes one of the versions in between as well, and then I get the finished product, and I'm so glad I'm here today, because it's only today I realize how the whole thing is shaped from this, you know, from what Akhila has written to what you know, Doug has kind of put together, and then finally you get to hear it on Spotify. So thank you so much for explaining that. It is mesmerizing, like Usha just I think mentioned. Thank you, thanks so much, and happy birthday, Doug.
Oh, thank you so much. This is a fun thing to do on my birthday, actually.
Got to do something musical, I mean, related to the music on your birthday, which, like, we planned. We wanted to release the album. I mean, you know, there was some time.
I mean, I basically got the masters. So the final process she mentioned is mastering. I just happen to have an old bandmate friend who's a really good mastering engineer in Los Angeles. And so he just sent us the masters back, the final product, pretty much on my birthday. So that was a pretty good birthday present alone, just to get the songs back.
Wonderful.
So we got a treat on your birthday.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming. Sorry to have you up late.
I think Monday.
It was a lovely session, both of you. I mean, both Akhila and Doug. Yeah, really nice to sort of hear the entire process. Yeah, so as Gitanjali said, I mean, of course, I come from a completely different sort of area of work, where we of course collaborate, but I can't ever think of asking somebody to set theorems to music. Maybe that's something we should think about also.
Why not?
Yeah, but it was really wonderful to listen to you both, and thanks so much. Thanks to Srilata for sort of organizing this whole event. And so I hope, Sai University's Creative Writing Center and the CMI Arts Initiative sort of organizes more such events. There's a wonderful first event for the Creative Writing Center to start off with, I think. It's wonderful.
So this is not our first event. This is not our first.
You said something about being the first event. No, no.
No, not at all.
Yeah, but
first Sai University.
First
in-house. In-house. Oh, Sai, okay. First in-house. Yeah, but never a great first event. Yeah, why not? So, thank you very much. And so we'll be in touch when we have more such events. Yeah. And thanks, everybody, for coming.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you all. Thank you. We have a web page. The Center for Creative Writing and Translation at Sai University has a web page. If somebody can, Bharat, do you think you can quickly put that in the chat box? I can't seem to I'm hopeless at this. So please go, and all of this will be recorded, and we already have an archive of recordings. And Akhila is, yes, happens to be from Sai University, but I'm just very glad to have her here. And, you know, so it's not just like an in-house talk in that narrow sense, but more than that.
Well, Doug made it not in-house.
So there's a message from Mara for both of you. Yeah.
Got it. Thank you.
So there's the website, the web page link also for those of you who are interested. Yeah.
Great.
So, bye, everybody.
Thank you so much.
Bye.
Leave. Everybody leaves.
Yeah.
Is
that the right thing to do? Thank you so much.
Yeah. Bye.
Thank you, Akhila.
Bye.
I think I'll leave the meeting now.
Yeah.
Bye.